You're listening to dialectradio.co.uk.
And I'm joined now by Patrick Henningsen. Hi, Patrick, and welcome to Dialect.
Hi, Tony. How are you?
Absolutely fine. Now, just tell us a little bit about the 21st Century Wire and your background.
Okay. Yes, I founded a website, which was a blog called 21stCenturyWire.com about 4 and a half years ago. And I'm a normal citizen who became, involved in the, called the anti-war movement. And I started writing, and I have a background in corporate communications and graphic design.
Great. Well, who did you work for as part of that? That sounds interesting. Corporate communications, this is PR, isn't it, for the big boys?
Yeah, I did. I did some interesting work. I worked for, I worked a little bit in the fashion industry and the sports industry, and also the electronics and technology industry, which was the most interesting because it's very competitive. And I got a little insight into how these companies go after each other in the blogs. So it was really interesting.
How do you mean go after each other in the blogs?
Well, when a new product is being launched, there's normally a race between two, three, or four companies, sometimes in different countries, and so they try like heck to promote their product to say that they can do things that they absolutely cannot do. Or that they're this much faster than the next one, and they're really not. Most of them are pretty much the same, and they make up all sorts of stories and pay thousands and thousands and millions of dollars. They pay different people. They have events, product launches, to exaggerate the performance of their Coke versus Pepsi. It tastes exactly the same.
Now, corporate communications, public relations, what did that teach you about what news we get from day to day? Because, I would imagine, actually working in that world is quite an insight into not just into the world you're working in, but how the media, the mainstream media works.
What it gave me an insight into is that there's a lot of news, Tony, that you see on the newspapers, on television, that's not news, actually. It's been paid for. It's been placed there by PR companies, or directly by the corporations themselves, who've produced a news segment, or have sent them footage, and then you have the news reader talking over it as if it's something that the news crew produced. I don't know if you have any experience, from the BBC, if you've seen that process happen, but I see a lot of headlines on the front of a lot of tabloids about statins. And I know exactly where that story comes from. It comes from the producers of those products.
How would you say is best, because obviously you do, as I do, we read between the lines, we'll say, well, hang on a minute, I don't trust that story, I don't trust that newsreader, I don't trust that outlet. How can you make that decision about whether a news story is genuine, it's finding its way through the system because it's genuinely of importance, and distinguishing between that and the spin, the public relations, where someone's actually just trying to sell you something at the end of the day?
Yeah, well, PR, the term public relations was invented by people like Mr. Edward Bernays or Mr. Lippmann in the 20th century, and that was a term they did to rebrand propaganda. So all public relations really is fundamentally is propaganda, but it's been given a nice soft, progressive term of public relations. But to know what's what, it's a very complex playing field, and it's really up to you to read a lot of different news sources. I read everything I can get my hands on in order to triangulate, what's real and what's not, and what's been derived from a PR campaign or what's being pushed. Because PR companies aren't just for toothpaste and mouthwash anymore. Political parties are actually hiring very expensive PR consultants in order to spin their propaganda. Or individuals hire them in order to, make them look good after a scandal has damaged their credibility, etc. So Max Clifford comes to mind. So it's highly complex, but I think most people you can use common sense, Tony, and if they know the media playing field a little bit, they can pretty much sniff a rat when it walks into the room.
Yes, certainly. And, I mean, that statin story is a great example, because a lot of it is, the idea is this is a dispassionate discussion about statins, but actually one of the sides there has paid somebody a lot of money to go in and bat for the statins, the drug companies, the pharmaceutical companies. I think, you know, fascinating to see some of the spin around the takeover by Pfizer of AstraZeneca, or the attempted takeover. There's absolutely multi-millions of profits at stake here, but that side of it isn't often dissected by the journalists. That's the problem. Anyway, we've got a particular interest, both of you and I, both keep an eye on the Bilderberg conferences. They started back in the 1950s with the former SS officer chairing them. That's Prince Bernhard of the Netherlands, after the war, and he was supposed to be a sort of nice, honest broker. I think a lot of people now speculating that actually there was still a little bit of SS blood running in his veins. But the Bilderbergs still meet. They're meeting this month, the end of this month, in a week or so's time, over in Copenhagen. I wonder, what's your take on whether the Bilderbergs are as powerful as some people say, or whether they are really just a private club having a little chit-chat on the quiet, you know, a bit of security, and whether it's an innocent thing, or whether these people are really wielding more power than we know?
Well, they're definitely not just a private club that goes and meets to play golf once a year in exotic or not-so-exotic locations like London or Switzerland, but they are a very real organization. You can trace their roots back to just after the end of the Second World War, and if you look at some of the accomplishments that we know now through you know, declassified documents or some very good books have been written, the European Union, the single currency itself, having its roots in actual steering committee meetings in the early days of the Bilderberg Group. But more to the point, in 2014, we're sort of probably about, you know, 30 or 40 years in of the culmination of research by a lot of individual independent journalists and researchers over the years that have exposed Bilderberg to the public. And I think right now Bilderberg is going through a little transition. They had a bit of a coming out party last year when they gave their guest list, or their guest list anyway, to the Telegraph newspaper. That was a first. And of course, a lot more media attention. And, you know, I think Charlie Skelton in The Guardian has done a pretty good job of elevating that issue into the mainstream public through his columns and covering it since 2008. And now it's kind of become more mainstream. So, but when Bilderberg started, Tony, they didn't have as many of these kind of high-flying confabs like they have now. We have Davos, World Economic Summit in late January, early February. That's in Switzerland. We also have the G8, the G20 meetings, and we've got a number of these other meetings that they've managed to, you know, I think the Bilderberg's important for these leaders from politics and from industry to come together to rubber stamp decisions on issues that affect big corporations, banks, and politicians in the transatlantic sphere, which is North America, Europe, and of course they bring in a few people to color up the guest list. But essentially, I think a lot of decisions are also being made, Tony, at some of these other meetings now that didn't exist 50 years ago.
Okay, so Patrick, what is studying the Bilderberg conferences and the organization, the Bilderberg meetings, taught you about the way power really works in the world?
Oh, well, it's funny because you know, my understanding has come together a little bit, especially last year when I saw Google had its big tent meeting in Watford, I believe a week or two before the actual Bilderberg conference was scheduled. And there was a big row out in public, and they said, oh, Google's not paying their fair share of corporate tax. How horrible this is. And George Osborne weighs in. He's a career Bilderberger, and other people weighed in. And then all of a sudden, we start hearing a call for a global taxation system. Surprise, surprise. And, of course, that was a big piece of the discussion, I believe, at Bilderberg last year. So you can kind of look and see what global issues get ballooned in the media in the run-up to Bilderberg. And then you've got the G8 last year in Ireland was directly afterwards. And, of course, they were talking about global tax for corporations. And, of course, the big corporations will not ever pay their fair share of tax, whether it's an issue or not. They're talking about tax for you and I, for the global citizen under their new regime. It's taught me to watch the media, Tony, in the run-up to Bilderberg and after, and see what the sort of global corporate, the one world corporate order, which is what I think it is, Trans-Pacific Partnership, Transatlantic Trade and Investment Partnership. That's Bilderberg to me.
And the other thing, of course, is that both George Osborne, Peter Mandelson from the Labour Party, George Osborne from the Conservative Party. We've also got Ed Balls from the Labour Party, David Cameron from the Conservative Party. It seems on the key economic issues, whichever way you vote, you still vote for Bilderberg. So what about ordinary folks like us? You know, what can we actually do to change things if whichever way we vote, we still get a Bilderberg economic policy?
Yeah, that's the problem. The problem, Tony, with Bilderberg and the problem with Davos, Davos is becoming more and more like Bilderberg. They're having closed session meetings during Davos where we have our elected officials showing up and meeting other policymakers from other countries and making decisions outside of our democratic process, even outside of the EU process, which you could hardly call democratic. But this is a huge problem. So basically, this subverts the whole concept of democracy. It subverts the whole concept of having constituency and electing their representative, going to parliament, making decisions on behalf of the constituency, and it's transparent. And so there's no transparency with Bilderberg. This is a big problem. So you could have decisions that are going to affect the lives of you, your family, your community, your nation, and you're out of the loop completely.
Yeah, but so what can we do?
Well, we've done, I think people, especially in alternative media, have done a lot of good work to expose Bilderberg, to bring the issue out into the fore, but my fear is they're going to crawl under another rock, and they've already started another confab at a certain time in the year to make steering committee decisions. I think what we have to do is enforce things like the ministerial code, clarify that, what is the minister's ability to go and meet while they're in elected positions.
Well, that's an interesting one, isn't it? Because, with these various ministers going to Bilderberg in Watford last year, they are actually breaking the ministerial code. So maybe what we have to do is just make sure that if any of our politicians do step into these secret meetings where they're making decisions, discussions all in secret, none of it, they are sworn by Chatham House rules not to disclose what's being talked about in there. So if any of them do that to make it hurt, in other words, they will lose their parliamentary position, their government position, and even stop being an MP if they enter those meetings under those terms.
I think you should be disqualified from office if you choose to attend a meeting like that. And in America, we have a law passed called the Logan Act, which is essentially the same thing. And it means that you can't sort of collude outside of the democratic process away from your constituency with foreign entities while you're in office. If you're a private businessman, that's fair enough. You can't do much about the corporates. But the fact when you got corporates intermingled with elected officials, to me, smells to high heaven of something that we absolutely should not stand for.
Totally agree. Can you just wind up, Patrick, by telling us about your website and where people can catch you online or on the radio, that kind of thing?
Yeah, you can catch myself and our reports at 21stcenturywire.com, and you can catch me every Sunday on the Sunday Wire radio show, which is a three-hour talk radio show between 5 to 8 p.m. GMT time.
And whereabouts can we find that online, that radio show?
You can find that at 21stcenturywire.com. We've got a live player on every Sunday night, and the archives of all the shows are available on our radio page on the website.
And I guess you'll be covering Bilderberg at the end of May, beginning of June this year.
Yeah, we'll definitely be seeing what's going on with Bilderberg, and we're really focused on the Ukraine and the economy and what's being planned for another run at Syria this summer.
Patrick Henningsen, thanks very much for joining us on Dialect.
Thanks, Tony.
You're listening to dialectradio.co.uk.